So this is Daniel. I will be speaking about the infrastructure as code from different perspectives. In this session, we will actually try to focus in infrastructure as code to drive or to perform cloud deployments, also to deploy against Kubernetes. Then we'll quickly covering some particularities about platform as a service offerings. And finally, focus in a specific tool that lets you deploy from configuration versus an alternative that lets you deploy from code. So before that, very quick introduction. This is Daniel Caballero Rodriguez. I've been working for Fastly almost 2 years now. I was previously a part-time teacher for La Salle University in a DevOps training course, and also previously working for Shipstead, that now is called Adivintia, and it's the company behind Spok and Willhaben, that I think they have some presence in Germany. I also eventually code a bit, and I try to share things as open source software. You have one example there, TCPGoon. And as I mentioned, I'm currently working for Fastly, and probably you already know what's Fastly. We can see Fastly as a CDN with superpowers. As I think the main difference with other offerings is that we let you run code in our Edge platform, so enabling Edge compute use cases. And this is a network map, so you can get into an idea the type of infrastructure we have, that it's distributed. We try to be as close as possible to your users, but also to accelerate the experience when browsing your website or when using your APIs. Why I'm speaking about infrastructure as code from a cloud provider perspective? The thing here is that we are also cloud provider users. So we have some orchestration services, a control plane, and we also consume other providers' cloud. So that's why we also use infrastructure as code. In addition, you can also consume or configure your Fastly configuration using the Terraform provider we maintain. So I think infrastructure as code is also very relevant to us. And preparing this talk, I realized there are some similarities between, let's say, supernovas and the status of infrastructure as code. In the picture, you can see the Crab Nebula that was originated by a supernova something like 7,000 years ago. I'm not an astronomy expert, but I think the similarities are very evident. One is that infrastructure as code is not a new thing. You have been already doing infrastructure as code before we had that term, probably when provisioning virtual devices, when pushing configurations against your vendor's API. So this has been there for a while, not so old as a supernova, of course, unless aliens did something before us. And another thing, similarity is that infrastructure as code today is a quite massive thing. So that means there are lots of tools, tools that were not infrastructure as code, but now they are also, covering some use cases. And in fact, the limits of infrastructure as code today are not so clear. Again, with this parallelism, the Crab Nebula in visible light may look as quite well-defined, but if you consider the rest of the spectrum, or if you consider also that we see an old picture of what it used to be, that nebula, plus that it's constantly expanding, the limits are not so clear. Another thing, supernovas, for instance, can trigger the creation of new stars, and these stars can eventually become also supernovas. The same probably applies to infrastructure as code. There are still news in that area, new tools, things arriving, patterns that are evolving. So I think it's worth to monitor this problem space. And in addition, I strongly believe that they are going to be with us for a long while. because services, applications, they do require a specific infrastructure configuration or platform configuration. I also tend to consider infrastructure as a dynamic infrastructure, that it's a well-defined term. So if you just consider infrastructure as a one-off thing, probably then this talk is not for you. I try to, let's say, build infrastructure in a way that it can evolve with the application. Another aspect to be in mind is that cloud providers, they currently have a big portfolio. And in the end, deploying something normally becomes like a composition exercise. That exercise is becoming challenging, and infrastructure as code may help you. And finally, there are more advantages that are well known of using as code alternatives to traditional ones. So yeah, in this session, I was browsing last year talks to see if there was something similar to this. Christian, that was actually the previous speaker, did present something that connects to this talk, but probably from a different angle. The talk was in German, so probably I missed 90% of the discussion, but the point is that the story was about transitioning from configuration, standard configuration management to, let's say, pipelines, delivery pipelines using Packer, Terraform, and immutable VMs. Today, the idea is just to, let's say, focus in cloud and platforms as a whole and see how we can orchestrate or configure things in these platforms. So today's talk is a lot about options. I will be presenting different tools, different approaches, and the idea is that you pick whatever is applicable to your use case, to your environment. And bearing in mind also one key message I would like to highlight is that Terraform may be good, but Terraform has been with us for quite a lot of time now. You know, in technology, things become outdated very quick. You can still use Terraform, and probably it's a valid solution for a big set of use cases, but there might be alternatives, and probably it's worth to assess them. For instance, in this picture, you can see the first recorded supernova that I think humanity discovered 200 years before Christ. And this is how it looks like today, but there are more supernovas, and some of them have some properties that makes them very useful, let's say, in research. So yeah, let's go for it. During the speech, the talk, you will see I will be categorizing a bit the solutions, the ones that are closer to configuration and the ones that are more driven by code. So and finally, we will be comparing two specific solutions. So the first block is about managing cloud resources with infrastructure as code. And we will start by, let's say, how I used to manage, my cloud configuration maybe 8 years ago. That was mostly with scripts. This is what I call raw infrastructure as code. So given your provider CLI, in this case, AWS, you can actually, automate the deployment with scripting. However, there are some inconveniences of doing that. That, for instance, if you, in this example where we are creating a couple of virtual machines and registering the virtual machines behind a load balancer, if we want to change the instance type, that means we need to also code the rollout logic, so the strategy to replace your existing stack or existing deployment by the new one with the new properties. You can do the same also just using API calls or your provider SDK for a specific programming language. Boto, for instance, is the first SDK for Amazon. In this example, you can see how this example will be recurrent. It's about how we are creating a bucket in S3. But in the end, it's the same model than the previous script. So then the AWS quickly realized about that this may not be, ideal. And they released CloudFormation now 10 years ago, maybe. And the good thing about CloudFormation is that you define a set of connected resources And that definition is something declarative. So compared to the previous script where we were saying step by step how to deploy your configuration in the cloud, with CloudFormation you define the desired state, and then it's CloudFormation the one that transitions your deployment into the desired state. CloudFormation supports JSON as in this example, but also YAML, and you can also inject configuration variables. The equivalent thing in Google Cloud is Google Deployment Manager, but it's a bit more powerful. It lets you also to define these templates with Python and things like that. This model of defining configuration files was quickly, let's say, identified by the community as something or an opportunity to do an equivalent definition, but with code. So despite in these examples, we will see tools or libraries letting you to write code to define your stack. In this case, we are not in the same model than just using scripting, because we are also declaring the desired state. We are not saying how to reach that state. It's just another way of writing a CloudFormation file. So Troposphere, it's inside this group of solutions. Troposphere is a Python library, and it lets you programmatically define the content of CloudFormation. So it gives you like functions, classes you can use to, in the end, generate your CloudFormation file. And a relatively new player in this area is Amazon Cloud Development Kit, CDK, that it's very similar to Troposphere, but it's multi-language. So CDK supports Python, but also I think it also supports Golang, and I think also .NET. So there are multiple options if you want to consume CDK. And in addition, they provide you like an additional abstraction layer. So some functions that lets you create stacks with some defaults. So tries to make your life easier to import the best practices to deal with a specific Amazon service. Finally, in this section, multi-cloud solutions. The most popular one is Terraform. Terraform builds on top of a HashiCorp configuration language. And it's again a declarative approach to define what you want to deploy. And Terraform is the one that pushes this desired state and converts that into an actual deployment or evolves an existing deployment. Again, the recurrent example of creating an S3 bucket. And given in Terraform V12, it's supported to define also stacks with JSON. So you are no longer limited to a HashiCorp configuration language. You can inject these JSON files. There are some initiatives, some projects that lets you also describe Terraform code, but the Terraform manifest, but with code. Terrascript, for instance, is a Python library in the example, we are creating a VPC. And the result of executing that snippet is going to be a JSON file you can converge using Terraform. And then another relatively new player in this area, Pulumi. It's, let's say, in concept, is similar to CDK, to Amazon CDK and Troposphere, but it's also multi-language, and in this case is multi-provider. So it doesn't mean that a specific receipt is something you can deploy multiple providers, but they, as happens with Terraform, you can define, let's say, you can use the same framework to orchestrate deployments being multi-cloud or porting an existing deployment from one place to another. So the API looks very similar to Terraform. So the functions they provide to you, they have the same parameters than Terraform. But you consume that from code, from your favorite programming language. By the way, we will cover this and Terraform in the last section in the comparison, so more details later. One table that tries to summarize all the solutions in this section. I bet the slides are gonna be shared, so you don't need to do screenshots if not already. People tend to like tables like this. I'm trying to categorize the solutions based if they are programmatic or not, if they are declarative or imperative, if they come with a deployment tool or they need another deployment tool. But yeah, that's just a summary of what we have already described. Let's now try to cover a bit Kubernetes and how infrastructure as code can be applied to Kubernetes. Probably you know a lot of Kubernetes, maybe more than me. And as probably you know, the Kubernetes, they offer you a big API with lots of objects. And in order to deploy your application, your service, you need to push a specific, let's say, configuration, objects configuration, so that it becomes the thing that Kubernetes is gonna deploy for you. This is the classical example, pushing an Nginx container to a Kubernetes cluster. And as if you are a Kubernetes user, you probably have already realized that it's a lot about YAML. In fact, I was very scared at the beginning. I found this short comic funny. And as happens with configuration-driven, let's say, platforms, one natural solution is to do templating. The most popular choice is Helm. And yeah, with Helm, essentially, you can reuse templates, you can inject variables. So if you have multiple deployments of a specific, let's say, service, you can model that in a way you can reuse the template, but inject a specific configuration for your specific deployments. An alternative, it's Kustomize, that it's maintained by the kube, the same kubectl maintainers. It's part of the tool now. And the idea is that rather than using templating, it uses a composition model. So you have something like a base YAML file, and you can apply patches that in the end is gonna bring the specific configuration you need for a given deployment. Let's also talk very quickly about operators in Kubernetes. It's relevant for us. So with operators, you can extend the Kubernetes functionality. So if you don't have enough with all the objects that came by default, you can have additional functionality and configure that functionality also using the same mechanisms. In Operator Hub, you have multiple examples of operators that enriches your cluster. For instance, you may find databases you can deploy. You can also find security or observability tools. So yeah, there's plenty of choices. And a couple of use cases that are relevant for infrastructure as code. One is, for instance, the Flux operator that lets you implement GitOps models. This morning, there was a specific talk about GitOps, so I'm not gonna enter into the details, yeah, but just get the idea that this lets you, let's say, connect this directly with your GitHub repositories. And another use case that is closer to infrastructure as code is, let's say, provider operators. In the example, you can see, for instance, how you can use the AWS operator to deploy a Dynamo table using the Kubernetes API. So rather than, let's say, invoking, let's say, Terraform or calling directly the AWS CLI to deploy a table your application may need and then deploy your application in Kubernetes. With that operator, you can just define not only your application, but this kind of dependencies in your cluster. And the operator is gonna manage that Dynamo DB table for you. So the concept is quite powerful. And in fact, there are more implementations. For instance, Crossplane is another operator that lets you, it's very similar in concept, but lets you manage multiple cloud providers. So it's multi-cloud. And at this stage, you may be thinking, okay, where is the code to drive Kubernetes, let's say, deployments? So some of the tools we have already seen, they are already covering this use case. Pulumi, Terraform, they have Kubernetes providers. So you can define also using Pulumi code or Terraform manifest a desired configuration that Pulumi or Terraform is gonna push to your cluster. But in addition, bear in mind that you can consume APIs from code. And in this example, for instance, you can see how to use the client, the Kubernetes client in Golang, to in the end define with code and specific deployment rather than defining the same with YAML. And yeah, and configuration of course can be generated programmatically. In this quick example I just did yesterday night, we can see how we can create a JSON YAML file from a Golang code snippet that when gets executed will result in this YAML. So yeah, before closing this big block of infrastructure as code for different use cases, let's see also some particularities about platform as a service. Platform as a service, it's like an additional abstraction layer. So that means that it tends to hide some infrastructure configuration, but you still need to configure your application requirements somehow. And the most of the tooling in this area, they let you define that configuration again in YAML files. In this example, the serverless framework to push your lambdas accepts CloudFormation like resources definition. So serverless is gonna also maintain these stacks for you. So then the final topic that it's also a big, let's say, it's something important for this talk. It's about how a solution that promotes configuration, Terraform, looks like compared to Pulumi, and how do they behave in front of very common needs. In this first example, in the top, you have the Terraform implementation for creating an S3 bucket. And in the bottom, the equivalent one with Pulumi, with Golang. As you can see, they look mostly the same in this simple example. In fact, as I was previously saying, the Pulumi one inherits the API definition from Terraform. So the new bucket accepts mostly the same parameters than the Terraform provider. However, when we start creating, let's say, most interesting stacks, I think the differences become more evident. In this example, we are defining a GKE cluster in Google Cloud, so a Kubernetes cluster. And a very common thing I've seen in Terraform manifest is people hardcoding availability zones, or maybe Terraform stacks accepting availability zones as parameters. And in this specific case, for instance, for me, specifying the availability zones is something that is not relevant. So having to hard code or to specify in the configuration and a specific availability zone is something I don't like to do, because I just want a group of availability zones. And if that maps to the availability zone B, C, and F, or A, B, and C, I don't care. You can try to do this with Terraform, but things become complex very quickly. While in this other example, where we are also defining a cluster configuration with code, we can, for instance, use a helper that can query the gCloud API and that can do the availability zone selection for you. So you can maybe say, okay, I need 3 availability zones, and this helper can do the job for you. If you need also conditionals or iterations in your Terraform code, you can do that. In Terraform V12, you have the for each and the dynamic blocks. Yeah, but they don't look very natural for a configuration language. However, with Pulumi, you can benefit from your programming language capabilities. And yeah, in this case, for instance, we are just iterating over a list of zones and invoking the Pulumi API several times. And yeah, and it's just code. More things about defining things with code. In this example, for instance, you can see a class that represents a load balancer, a redirect-only load balancer in Google Cloud. And you can just consume this class and create multiple instances with different configuration. So reusing things become more natural. You can also put that class into a pip. In this case, this is Python, so you can put this into a pip package and reuse this just using Python pip. In Terraform, you can also use modules, and you can encapsulate modules and share modules using Terraform Enterprise or GitHub. But it's a bit like reinventing the wheel. And in addition, yesterday Pulumi released a blog post where it's announcing the release of the automation API. So you no longer need to wrap your Terraform apply or Pulumi app command with scripts or make files. You can also invoke Pulumi or converge and stack from code. In this example, for instance, it's a Golang snippet. We are using a Cobra, the Cobra package to define a command for a CLI tool. And for instance, the add command can create a virtual machine for you in your code. That helps you to create more complex workflows. You can do pre-checks. So everything becomes like more programmatic and more powerful with these kind of functionalities. So just as a summary and highlighting also some advantages of using things like Pulumi, you can abstract things using your programming language. You can test. There is a link to the testing guide for Pulumi. You can see you can apply unit testing, integration testing. You can apply the clean code practices, benefiting from years of code development. And probably it's easier to engage your development team if you want to implement a you build it, you run it culture. So yeah, my point is why do we need to reinvent the wheel again and again on top of a new configuration language if you can define your desired configuration with code? So before closing, some final remarks, the main messages. For me, infrastructure as code is still very relevant and important in DevOps. If you are using platform as service or Kubernetes, you still need some form of infrastructure as code. There are plenty of options. And if you use a programming language for that, you just benefit from lots of things rather than reinventing them. I've used during the slides some Creative Commons images. These are the attributions. And thanks for your time. Hope you get a clear idea of this. I don't know if we have time for questions, but it's the right moment.